Pensado's Place is brought to you by Avid, Vintage King, Recording Connection.
How branding begat an incredible production career. We've got stuff from Isotope. We've got stuff from AEA. We've got stuff from AES. We also got our big Nashville trip coming up. You're at the place. It's Pensado's Place.
Yay!
Hey, everybody. Thanks for dropping by. It's going to be a great show. Glad you could make it, Herbert.
How are you, man?
You know, it's...
There's a lot going on
Well,
today.
You know, we say that, but we encourage it and thrive
we
on
do.
It.
You right. know? We wouldn't know what to do without it. Right.
When I'm working, I want to be fishing. When I'm fishing, I'm scared I'll never work again, you know?
I don't know if you're going to be fishing anytime soon. That's for sure.
Well, they got some good lakes in Nashville.
Oh, that's true. And we're heading down there. We'll talk about that in a minute. Tell me about a good thing happened with Mixer Man and your involvement.
Oh, right? Yeah. The daily adventures of Mixer Man. Dylan and myself and several other guys... We helped Mixer Man make an audio version of his book, The Daily Adventures of Mixer Man, and it's been nominated for a Grammy.
That's fabulous.
I think I'm going to win an Oscar for this.
Herb. I think you may.
Anyway, it's on YouTube. Check it out. The Womb is part of I forget the exact. Anyway, go to Mixer Man YouTube. You'll find it.
So congratulations to him and to
yeah,
you guys.
Yeah, it's a great book.
That's a fabulous thing. We are in the middle. We're about three quarters through with our book, right?
Yeah, yeah. Actually, three quarters. I was thinking, golly, we're that far along.
Unbelievable, ooh. Right? It's been a fun process.
Yeah, we've just so you guys will know, we've taken great care to give you something that you're going to really like and use on multiple levels. Mm-hmm. It's if you care about us, it's going to be interesting to you. If you don't, we got some little things in there to help you with your career and stuff.
That's right. Shout out to Marine Droney for
everybody. Homework. Always asks Herb for you to. Drop more pearls of wisdom in terms of all that, and this book is chock full of that. So you're going to get a lot of Herb that
I had to come up with something to just keep up with you. That's really what it was.
Well, you know, everybody knows I've said this before, but 95% of everything I say is true.
Yeah, so, right. Now different people have different percentages.
Well, you try to go for 100. That's why it took you a little harder.
So why don't we get to the business at hand?
What yeah, save me from this.
All right, no problem.
Save me from myself.
Hey, folks. Great to see you. Hope you're having a fantastic week. So much is going on. Fast approaching is our trip to Nashville. We are thrilled, to say the least.
Easily.
Your email registrations are pouring in. The Pensado's Place Tricks and Treat Q&A at beautiful Belmont University on Music Row is on and popping. And let me tell you, it's on and popping. There is still room, so get to it, register, and we want to see you.
Yeah, we want a big turnout.
Here's the deal. On Halloween, October 31st at 6 p.m. at the Curb Event Center, Dave and I will be there to discuss audio, answer your tech and career questions, give out treats, take pictures, shake your hands. We want to get to meet you. But wait. That's not all.
yeah, fish. How's the ShamWow going?
I got the thing down here in a minute.
Since fish on the show.
We'll do that in a second. Since we announced last week, we've been contacted by some very special friends of ours, and they wanted to also stop by and share their expertise with you and meet you. So here you go. Charlie Peacock. Ooh. Charlie produced and engineered Civil War, Switchfoot, and Amy Grant. He'll be there. Vance Powell, engineer Jack White, Kings of Leon, Buddy Guy, Leanne Rhymes, White Stripes, Keb Moe, wow. He'll be there. F. Reed Shippen did Jewel, Keith Urban, Johnny Lang, and by the way, is a Middle Tennessee State University grad. He'll be there. So MTSU, you better represent.
And we'll be there.
Well, I think actually we should just sit in the audience at this stage of the game. Why are we even going? Yeah. These are Grammy winners and nominees and incredible talents in their own right. Couldn't wait to participate. It's your chance to get your questions answered and take pictures of the legend.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
We've been going over some of the prizes that, I guess you'd call them prizes, some of the little gift bag things. It's going to be a chock full of great gifts.
It's
but
not
the
gift
greatest
bags, but...
prize of all is...
What?
They get to hang with us a little later on, right?
Not necessarily. You're getting ahead of me. So you calm down, let me handle it. But wait, it gets better. So our friends at Waves, Isotope, Avid, Vintage King, McDSP, and Audio Technica all have stepped up really big. They're giving about 50 prizes for Dave and I to bring to you.
Wow, 50.
Some of them well over $1,000 in value. This is rare to get, and big ups to them. So here's stuff you can win: RX3, Alloy 2, Ozone, Stutter Edit, and more from Isotope. Inbox Pros and Pro Tools 11s from Avid. McDSP is giving their Retro Pack native bundles. Waves is giving gold and Program A certifications. More stuff is coming down the pike from Audio Technica and Vintage King. And we're just going to give them out for the craziest stuff. Throw on your best Halloween contest. We're going to give 3 or 4 prizes for that. Ask great questions. We'll give prizes for that. Sit in the right section. We'll give prizes for that. Who came the farthest? Rep your school. Best couple. Prizes for teachers who attend. Ladies, we want you there as well. It's going to be our version of Oprah's Greatest Thing. We're just going to give everything away short of a car.
No, we got a car.
Oh, we did.
Yeah, Vintage King is providing a brand new Mercedes.
And right now, the sound you hear are people in Detroit falling over because they didn't know that. Look, we're looking for pros and amateurs, students and teachers, lots of schools in that area: Vandy, MTSU, Lipscomb, Art Institute, SAE, Tennessee State, Fisk, of course Belmont University, and then all the other audio programs and studios in the surrounding states. Come on down.
Lots to give away,
lots of fun, lots of learning. And then there's the pièce de résistance.
Okay, Fish, what is it?
Here we go. So we're going to pick 8 of you to attend a really exclusive all-star reception with some of Nashville's best in class, literally. John and Martina McBride have graciously, they've been so supportive. They've opened up the legendary Blackbird Studios on Saturday, November the 2nd. We're having a private dinner, which we're going to tape for an episode later. We'll tell you about that later. And we're also having a reception in Martina's personal room. We've gathered 20 of the leading engineers, top producers, session musicians, songwriters, and possibly a couple of stars for that dinner. That dinner is being catered by Flight, which is a tremendous restaurant in Nashville. And Chef Matt is going to personally handle this. It's a very, very special thing. We're going to have 8 of you. We're going to pick 8 of you to attend the reception for that dinner, to mix and mingle with some of the best. And I can tell you personally that for Dave and I both, events like this were game changers in our careers. Mm-hmm. When you get that kind of all access that some people never get in their life, and be able to get next to somebody who may become a mentor or may inspire you or pick up some information, that's hard to get. And we want to give that opportunity. So we're going to pick 8 of you to attend that. So get your buns to the Q&A, get a chance to win this. This is literally Dan Huff, just amazing producers, Justin Niebanks, Martina's going to be there.
Top 10.
These are huge guys, engineers from Lady A and from Zach Brown. Crazy. Legendary studio, legendary people, legendary opportunities. Learn from the masters. Here's how you do it. Really simple. Sign up at pensadosplace.tv/tricks and tricks. Tricks and treats, sorry. pensadosplace.tv/tricks and treats. Enter your name, your email, city, state, and school. Again, don't have to be a student, only school if applicable, and then you're good to go. It's just that simple. Pro, amateur, student, teachers, male, females, dogs, cats, dragons, everybody get there. Really quickly, the people who made this possible, we'd be remiss if we didn't mention. So, Vintage King for your support, Recording Connection for your support, Audio Technica and Studio 202 out of DC have all made this possible for us to come to you. We love you. We can't wait. We're a few weeks away.
Thanks, guys.
It's going to be exciting, right?
I can't wait.
Me too.
I've got so much history in Nashville, you know, growing up in the music industry in Atlanta.
Yep. It's a big deal. The town has opened up for us, and it's pretty amazing. All right, moving forward. You know what to do there. We're having fun with Isotope, right?
I love this wheel.
The wheel is the coolest thing. So why don't we spin this boy and get us a winner?
Are you still going to do the Vanna White dress next week with
this? Maybe. They're fitting it.
Okay, good.
Yeah, I need to put a bustle.
I can't wait to see that.
On it. Okay, cool. So you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
All right, here we go.
Ooh.
Alloy 2. Ooh. Who's the winner?
Matt Shorter is the winner.
Let's give him a hand. Matt Shorter, well done, well done. So we'll get that information to you, Matt.
I use Alloy 2 every mix.
You use Alloy 2 a lot?
I use everything on the wheel except that blue one with your face on it a lot.
Well, you actually use that blue one with my face on it a lot, too. So,
true.
Isotope, you know we love you, and that's
absolutely
great stuff. Matt, congratulations. And now, let's move to our friends at AEA.
Quick iStock thing.
Okay,
I got a new plugin from them that is like a monster. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to tell everybody about it.
Oh, yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay, so our buddies at AEA.
Wes is under there somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. They've launched their new N22 ribbon mic. Mm-hmm. We were in the studio last week, and Julian David, who does their marketing, brought one over. What was your initial reaction to it?
Without hearing it, I was very impressed. You hold it, it's hefty. Cole was playing with it, and I was playing with it, and Cole recorded a vocal with it, and it's spectacular.
Really?
It really is good.
Oh, that's fabulous.
I mean, it's you know, we wouldn't have it on the show if it wasn't.
Right, absolutely.
But Cole brought me back a report that it was the high end was spectacular, the mid range was full and mm-hmm. rich. It's a great microphone, very affordable, by the way.
Yeah, really specifically for the home studio enthusiast, for the singer-songwriter. So in about 4 weeks, we're going to do a drawing. You can win a bunch of different things. You can win the N22. You can win an RPQ500 preamp, an SMP17 stereo mic positioner, and even more. Thanks to the guys at AEA. They are tremendous folks. Here's how you enter that. PensadosPlace.tv/N22, submit your name and email, and you're in. We'll have Wes on the show to draw it probably 3 weeks or so.
I forgot about that.
The other thing is you're going to do an ITL on the mic, right?
Can't wait.
Okay, cool. One last shout out before we get to the show. Our boy Chevy is having a function at AES. For all those who are in New York and will be at AES, stop by Chung King, which is a legendary studio in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. He'll have demos during the day and then from 12 to 5. And then at night, he's having what he calls the Afterglow Party from, I think, 6 to 10. Click the links that you see in the show. Tell Chevy we sent you. We're one of the sponsors. Get there. It'll be a bunch of fun. So,
good job, Fish.
Lots of information. Why don't you introduce the ITL, sir?
I came up with a couple of new things for slap delay, so I want to share that with you. Okay, guys, I'm going to slap you today and show you some new things about delays I've been playing with lately. Cole and I have been experimenting with slaps on slaps, and it's been really cool, and we've come up with some stuff I want to share with you. Now, we call it a slap delay. It started during the tape days, and all studios had two tape machines. They had the 2-inch tape machine, or the multi-track tape. Sometimes they were 1-inch, and then they always had another machine, the 2-track machine, that everything was printed onto, and that's what was sent to mastering. Now, the 2-track machines at one point were 1/4-inch, and then they became 1/2-inch tape. What we used to do back in the day is we would take a 20-foot piece, 30-foot piece, any amount you wanted, the shorter the better, and we would we'd splice it together and make an endless loop. Now, what we would do is we'd take this endless loop, we'd thread the tape machine, we'd set a mic stand over here, run it to the outside, the loop, come back around behind the tape machine or in front of the tape machine, whatever you want to do, and then around behind this mic stand over here, and then back through the electronics and the heads on the tape machine. So we've got an endless loop going around two mic stands and through the tape machine. And then there's always a mechanism on the tape machine that would turn it off when the tape ran out. And what you'd have to do is you'd have to tape that in place so the tape machine would keep running. Now, what you would do, the tape machine has three heads actually. It had an erase head, and then it had a playback head, and we call it repro head, and it has a sync head. And the sync head is what did the recording. The playback head just played back. Now, the gap between the record head and the playback head is the amount of delay you're going to get. So what you do is you feed the signal that you want to put a slap on. The amount of delay depends on the speed of the tape and the headspace between the gap between the headspace, physical gap. Usually it's about this big. And the slap would end up being anywhere from 70 to 120 milliseconds, depending on all these things. And you would take the output of the tape machine and you would bring that back into a channel on the board, stereo channel. And then you would take the signal that you wanted to have the slap on, usually a vocal, and you would send that to the tape machine. So are you with me now? We've got signal coming into this endless loop of tape. The gap between the record head and the playback head becomes a delay because we're monitoring the delay, the repro head, the playback head. And nowadays, we just pull up a plug-in or a delay. And so, to me, everybody has a different time for slap. Slaps, to me, are somewhere between 75, 60 milliseconds and maybe 125. Some numbers work. Now, you find slaps just by experimenting. You don't want the slap to be an increment. Like, you don't want it to be a 32nd. You don't want it to be a 64th, because then it's not a slap. It becomes on a beat, and it doesn't give you what you're trying to get. So this is kind of like a classic slap. I've got 67 on one side and 79 on the other.
You changed my mind.
That's dry. Here's with the slap.
You changed my mind this time around. Open my eyes to your world. If I got to get myself in...
So I'm gonna take it off while it's going. You'll see what it tends to do.
You changed my mind this time around. Open my eyes.
Okay, your basic, kind of boring slap. Now, let's nuke that one. Now, I experimented with Manny's plugin, and I'll leave this up for a second so you can copy my settings. I really like this slap, so let's check this out. Without it.
You changed my mind this...
With it.
You changed my mind this time around. Open my eyes to your world. If I got to get myself in line...
Okay, what is my delay here? My delay looks like 120. And then now with this plug-in, I can add a little bit of reverb, a little distortion, a doubler effect, a pitch type thing, and a little bit of phase. Now, Cole actually stumbled on this. I like this plug-in here. Is a delay. What I've done is I put this up in multi-mono. So now I've got two mono versions I can play with. Now you can use, if you don't have Pro Tools, you can just use two different auxiliary tracks. So now when this plugin comes up, I can have one setting for the left and one setting for the right. Now, this particular plugin doesn't give you actual numbers, but you can tell. Watch this knob here. I'm using a little bit of modulation. This would be more like a feedback. I'm not using any of the original signal. Now this is what I've got on the other side. So I've got more of an echo, less of a doubler, a lot less sustain, more saturation, and a shorter delay. So let's check this out by itself.
You changed my mind this time around. Open my eyes to your world. If I got to get myself in line.
Okay. Now, when you use both of them, something really cool happens. Mathematically, I'm not quite sure what. I just know I like it. Watch this. So what we've got is these two plugins right here. This is just the Manny plugin and this one. But now you can do it with any two plugins, but I just happen to like these.
You changed my mind this time around. Open my eyes to your world. If I got to get my...
Okay, now let's put it back where we'd use it. That's a little hot. Okay, here's with it.
You changed my mind this time around. Open my eyes to your world. If I got to get myself in line.
Hey, come on, guys. That's kind of cool. I like that. Now, Manny's plugin saves me from loading up five more plugins, but you can see that the combination of two different slaps is something that'd be kind of hard to do with a tape machine and mic stands, and then you'd have to use all these extra things. Check it out. Experiment. Try different things. And I'm telling you, when you put this in the mix, it just grows. And now you could use this for guitars. You could use this for synths, keyboards, all kinds of stuff. Let me know what you come up with, all right? See you guys.
That's David P. on Slap. Take that information, incorporate it into what you do like you usually do. And you know what's a really cool thing that people don't know about the show? Is that your ITLs are seen as much as the show is seen.
Wow.
Literally. It's pretty cool, huh?
Yeah, it's some of the things involved with the show just don't register.
I know, it's pretty mind-boggling.
Like, I can't figure out what infinity is. I can't even figure out what zero is.
Anymore,
nothing,
huh?
Doesn't, I don't know. And the show, so many of the things that have happened good for us in the show, I just
can't
fathom.
Yeah, it is. And part of the reason it's good is because of the incredible guests that we get each week. This week, we are pleased to have two guys. What's so fascinating as I've met these guys is that they have a business approach to what they do, even though they like to have fun. Welcome, Cosine and Two from The Interns. What's
yes,
happening?
Sir. Fellas, so, yes, fellas, fellas, thanks
Thank
for having us.
Welcome.
Yes,
it was absolutely our
honor.
Pleasure. David was very excited to land you guys. In fact, which we can tell, he said, meet me and ride with me to the show.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, Cosine called me up and said, if I'm not on the show, the Polaroids go out tomorrow.
I've seen the Polaroids.
I thought I looked kind of cute. But
fire away, David.
Guys, you know what? So, this happens to you guys also. So many times people ask me, and I know they ask you, so maybe we can do a public service here. I got this track. I did this track. How do I get it to the people that can use it? How did you go from being very creative in writers in Chicago to getting tracks placed? Was there a process? A little luck involved?
It's all of the above. You know what I mean? It's absolutely guerrilla warfare. You know what I mean? You try everything. Two just spoke about, you know, what he thought was our big break, so I can talk about that. You mm-hmm. know. I was at Columbia College in Chicago, and I was teaching there at the moment.
Mm.
And I was on a panel, and there was a guy, CL, who has a website, Dizzy Wax, which is like a record pool place. And yep. he just said some cool stuff on the panel. So afterward, I'm like, yo, you know, I don't know how long you're in town, but you know, we got tracks. This is Chicago. You should let me take you to Uncle Remus on the west side. The chicken wings are crazy.
Right, right.
Luckily, he didn't have anything to do, so grabbed him some wings, brought him by the studio. Played him some music, and you know he was like, I know you know me as CL from Digiwax, but I'm also partners with Mims, and we're about to do his second Ooh, album, and this wow. shit is crazy. And he called Mims on the spot, and I called too, like, yo, it's about to happen. And then it went silent for about 2 or 3 months, and we didn't know, was he just, you know what I mean, was
sure.
he just that?
Right.
And then he called back, they flew us to Atlanta.
How many tracks did you give him?
We did. Oh, at the time?
Or 100.
No, at the time, I didn't give him anything. We just played him music.
Okay.
And he was like, yo, you have to come to Atlanta, because we were telling him, like, we're not just, and we didn't have any real placements, but we tell him out the gate, like, we're not beat producers. Like,
right.
if you put us in the studio and allow us to see what he's up to and let us build, we can go in and do something crazy.
You're big picture guys.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
so we were able to co-executive produce.
Really? Right yeah. from the top?
That's how we came in the game. You know
yeah.
what I mean? With half the album.
I've known you guys since the 40s.
Since the
40s. That's even cooler than I thought it was going to be.
Absolutely.
So somewhere in that journey, Sony ATV, you literally got a publishing deal before you had hit songs, correct?
Yeah. I had a nice relationship with a guy by the name of Vincent Herbert.
Sure.
And
yeah, just some guy named Vincent.
Yeah. Just some guy, Vincent Herbert.
Right,
and it's crazy. We used to come back and forth to LA. I used to always see him in the airport.
Uh-huh.
And he was traveling like with Tony Braxton and Tamar. At the time, he was managing Tony.
Mm-hmm.
He was like, yo, man, what you guys up to? What you doing? What you doing? He said, anytime you guys out in LA, you need to talk, just hit me up. So I just called him and I was like, yo, man, just give me 5 minutes.
Yep.
5 minutes. And at this time, you know, we was beyond broke.
Right.
You know, no heat, everything.
Right.
So I'm just like, 5 minutes, and we found some money, got on a plane to LA, and it's crazy because before we took off, I looked close in the face. I was like, yo, we're not coming home broke. He was like, yo, man, whatever. He said, whatever.
I was already checked out.
Yeah.
Right.
And
right.
Get on the plane. Had a meeting. Vince couldn't believe he wasn't signing anybody. At this time, you know, when they say it rains, it pours.
Yeah.
Like, at this time, we get the call about Mims and to do half of, you know what I'm saying, the project. And then he was like, yo, I'm going to introduce you guys to Jody Gerson.
Mm-hmm.
So we meet with Jody. She checks some music out. 2 to 3 weeks later, not only are we working with Mims, they put that single out ASAP.
Wow.
So now we have a conversation to talk to her about. We signed a Sony ATV.
Got a check.
Got the check. And
turned on the heat.
Oh, my God.
And moved out to L.A. and started the dream, man.
There you go.
And here we are.
Let me ask you guys something. This just came in my mind. Herb, help me frame this.
But,
we can all think of a lot of producers that work alone, but it seems to me there's a lot that work in teams, and the guys that work alone have the partner. They just don't credit him.
Yeah.
But could you guys have made it had you tried to do it individually? The team part of it
is
very important.
Impossible. Because you know what? Let me tell you the story about how we first met is so crazy because this guy Kevin Shine brought me to 2&2 was running this indie record label Conquer Records, and I played him some music, and he's like, "Yeah, man. Yo, your beat's whack, homie." Just like off top. Just
right away.
And he still does it to this day. I'll show you the emails. He says.
Off top. Yo, your beat's whack, homie. But you cool. You know what I'm saying? We trying to build the team or whatever, blah, blah, blah. And like, I was offended, of course. But like, nobody had been that honest with me.
That's right.
Well, did you think your beats were whack?
I did a little bit, too. Man. I was like, my beats are kind of whack.
But I press play for him, though. I did press play for him.
Yeah.
Were they really whack, though?
Yeah, yeah. But I'll press play and say, you're supposed to sound like this.
Yeah.
And just look them in the face.
Yeah.
So I did have something for him. I didn't just say, yo, it's whack. Yeah. And,
I actually had something to play for him.
Yeah.
Like, two was the man at this little indie label, and he had, you know, golden ears, and so he taught me how my music should sound. You know what I mean? Mm. And so like to this day, Two doesn't touch the equipment, but he'll come in the room and he'll either drop off a stack of samples. He'll be like, "Yo, that's crazy." Like even yesterday, I was stuck on this Bruno track, and like I had to just listen to him just beatbox the whole beat. Mm. I'm like, "What? I'm stuck," and he'll just beatbox it, and I can just make what he says come out through the speakers.
Oh, I'd love to watch.
You know, that's the way dance started, right? He just came in and just started going ass.
Why not? Shine had that. Shine was like, "Yo, I got this idea," and he was scared to say it.
Uh-huh.
And we was like, "Come on, man, say it."
Yeah.
So you know, we all had a couple of drinks, and he was like, "All right, here we go." Ass. And he was like, he started doing it. And we was like, that's tight, that's a hit.
Yo, you brilliant, dog.
Super serious, man. He was like,
serious.
You guys like that? You like that? We was like, go in the booth
straight,
right now.
Straight to work.
Straight to work.
It was
straight
literally like, I just feel, it's kind of embarrassing, man, because like that's so how it happened.
But I mean, that's Big Sean's probably his biggest record, isn't it?
We definitely owe over 2
it's
million.
It's your biggest record.
Wow.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah, big record for us, man. Actually, you know, it's crazy how your life changed in so many different cycles through the music business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And for us, that was like, that's the one where it's just like, I got kids, I'm taking care of my kids with no problem, I'm paying bills with no problem, you know? You can help your family out here and
there. That's right.
So now you've got somebody in your camp just walking around the room going ass.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, move me from that moment in time. What happened next, guys? You sat down and did you record him doing that, and then you built a drum part around that next?
Yeah.
When did the chord changes come?
Yeah, he goes ass, and that's why it's just a clap.
That's not just a clap. That's the intern's clap.
Yeah, and everybody took that and ran with it. Yeah. We did it, but it's cool. Shout out to everybody that made money. Because we made money.
I sampled it. I used it on quite a few records, too. I didn't think about it. I could have just gone to Jason and got the original.
You got the files right from him, right?
But so the intern's clap started it out, which is genius.
We did the clap, and we have been doing that for a little second.
So when did the actual kick and snare came next?
The drum kick snare came.
And what was your inspiration for that besides the fact that you're from Chicago and listen to too much house music?
Yeah, like the juke movement. Like I don't know if people know that much, but like it's called juke music. It's like a house thing. Like it's just like that bounce and how the 808 moves has always been a part of what we do.
That's one of your signatures.
Yeah, one of our signatures.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we just went right to it because the idea was let's just lay something out so that we can feed off of this energy of the room. Uh-huh. So it was just, you know, just drums and Sean just going in. And then what happened was after he like freestyled his little verse and did that hook,
Sean.
Mm-hmm.
Sean.
I got stuck again. You know what I mean? Like I started trying to play stuff and I just was stuck. So then the whole thing of like Now make that motherfucker Hammer Time. Every time he said that, it was just like, all right, make it Hammer Time. Okay, cool. MC Hammer, what's on that? I remember him when he like, break it down now.
So that's how the Vanilla Ice thing came.
Yeah, no, the MC Hammer can't touch this. Yeah, so we so we just grabbed that piece because I was, you know what I mean, we stuck, threw that in there and then just sped it up double time.
It went crazy.
And it just went crazy.
Ran around the whole room like for an hour a day.
Because you know
it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. I used to, go ahead. No, I was going to say, it's just, I was going with you. When I had my management company, I used to tell my staff, you don't have to ever debate a hit. A hit will make you jump up and run around.
Oh,
you know, right?
Yeah.
And particularly Golden Ears.
Yeah.
You know from the top.
Yeah.
Golden Ears. No discussion.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
Not if I do this.
We was like very excited.
So you knew right there.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's one thing that, you know, if it's a piece of advice that, you know, I give to anybody making music, like, focus on how it makes you feel.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Like, I do so much music and listening with my eyes closed. Because that sense is a distraction. It's not about what it looks like. Music doesn't look like anything. Stevie Wonder and Ray Charles will tell you that, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But how it makes you feel as you listen to it, you know, sometimes the kick is off a little bit, but it just feels right, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And that's, the room was just going, everybody was just, I wasn't even in it like everybody else. I was like, okay.
Okay, something's happening.
Oh, yeah.
You know what? Let me make another point to you.
Whenever
anybody goes to a show with me, they always say, why are you looking around? Because when a show is right and you turn around and look at the crowd, that's telling you what's connected.
Yeah,
absolutely. Because you gotta read that room.
Absolutely.
And yeah, yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh, fascinating, fascinating.
What?
Oh, we don't need you. Just anyway, back to the matters at hand.
So, did you meet with any resistance to the song along the way after you finished it?
Oh, man. Man, yo, this is crazy, right? So Sean is doing his album. He's over there with No ID. And we are texting Sean, calling Sean to finish the record. Nothing, you know, he's on tour doing his thing. Went over with No ID, and it was his one record that was called Dream Seller. That had Chris Brown on it that he did for his album. And that was the only song we had besides, you know, the Ass record. And No ID was like,
the Ass record.
Yeah.
That's a great career.
The Ass record. And No ID was like, yo, I really need one of these like young records for him. And this, I'm like, yo, bro, we got it. We've been had it.
Right.
And he was like, let me hear it. Press play. He was like, oh my God. He was like, Sean has to finish this record. Soon as he come off the road, he has to finish this record. Soon as Sean came off the road, No ID made sure he got in and finished the record. So shout out to No ID.
Yeah.
You know, for putting the pieces together.
Talented guy.
And Sean was just kind of, he was just kind of iffy on, yo, this may make me look corny. I don't know what my fans may think. I don't know about this record.
Right.
Yeah, it's good, it's fun, but I just don't know how people may look at me. And here we are.
Here we are.
Like, damn near 3 million records later.
Wow.
To me, it feels like, and I don't mean to be disrespectful, but it has a vibe and a feel of like early Missy Timbaland in it. You know, it's very sparse, and everything has to carry weight. Mm-hmm. I know you guys didn't rip that off, but what I'm saying is I like the sparseness, the fact that every track, without it, the song falls apart. There's no fad in there. It's just, it's a great song. I mean, the first time you hear it, the until you get to about the second verse, you're like, I don't know about, this is incredible. And then you go around the house all day.
And then you're infected, like you can't get it out of your head.
Some of the chord changes, you're a pretty good keyboard player. You've been trained somewhere along the line.
I hang out with way too many amazing musicians to agree with that ever. I'm sorry. I'm the fakest keyboard player you will meet. In the studio, I will play it over and slow it down and press one if I have to, play it back and add. I'm not doing that shit straight through.
I got you. But it works.
But it works. Gotcha. Absolutely.
So on Meyer Hawthorne, Backseat Lover, there's a lot of amazing musicians on that record.
Yeah,
were you outclassed on that record, or how'd you pull that together?
No, you know what?
That's one of my favorite things you guys have ever
done.
Well,
thanks a lot.
My favorite thing we're about to get to, I'm going to save that for a second.
Got it. Yeah, but we had a lot of fun. We have a band that we call Affordable Healthcare.
Oh.
Right?
Oh my God.
It's our secret production band, you know what I mean? And it's Affordable Healthcare because it's so musical and everybody needs that. You need that. You
yeah,
know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so we have Kevin Randolph playing. Mm-hmm. We have Eric Jackson playing. Mm-hmm. And
is that you playing Rhodes on that?
It's Kevin playing Rhodes.
And who's playing the guitar?
And Eric Jackson's playing guitar.
Oh, wow. Tell him I'm a guitar player. Tell him I said good
job.
Oh,
he did incredible. Yeah, the bass is James Manning. Mm-hmm. Wow. And then just extra, like, some of the lead stuff and then drum programming and then just us going back and forth setting up the song, you know, to kind of just bring it all the way home. But it was such a joy to make because me and Hawthorne came in and we had, you know, you have beats and you play it for people. And he just knew exactly what he wanted. He was turn on some Steely Dan.
Yeah, we had like a 2-hour vibe session, man, of just like catalog music that he loves. Yeah.
For
like
me,
crazy.
It feels like Smokey Robinson meets Hall & Oates.
Mm-hmm.
Especially new Hall & Oates with Daryl's House kind of Hall & Oates. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. What a great record.
Yeah, it's so fun because, you know, the charts, the changes, you know, and just being able to. The thing about producers, and I don't encourage, I'm not saying that it's mandatory that you have to, you know music theory, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. but it's cool when you know a little something so that you can speak the language to your musicians, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? And it's like, yo, you know, that's too dark, or, you know, your chords are too clustered, spread out the voicings and stuff like that, and be able to go mm-hmm. back and forth, because once you're able to get it right, and once it starts to get that feeling, it's incredible. We appreciate Mayor Hawthorne so much for giving us that opportunity.
Yeah, what a great record, too. And speaking of great records, Ricky Ricardo.
Hey!
Man, Captain, and Captain is spelled with a K when you go to look it up. Go look it up. I grew up in South Florida, so Ricky Ricardo is somebody we all know where I come from. But how did that come about?
Man, so this is how the record came about, and this is real life.
Okay.
So I call Coast, I'm in Chicago, and I'm just like, yo, man, at the time I was messing around with this young lady, can't say any names, mm-hmm. And I'm just like, yo, man, this chick right here is just wishy-washy, up and down, just getting on my nerves or what have you. And Coast was like,
you know how when somebody's talking so much and for so long about nothing that it just turns into just like, rah, 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 rah.
Just white noise.
So I'm just like, bro, like, you know you like that shit, man. You know you're not about to leave her. Like, you know you on your Ricky Ricardo, should be back. Oh, you know that's what you want.
And we was like,
he instantly goes, oh, that's a song.
That's a song. Instantly, right, we on the phone, we like, I say, yo, that's a song. He's like, oh. That is a song.
Ricky Ricardo, shit.
Hold on. So we was going back and forth. And I was like, you know what? I got something for it right now. I'm sending it right over to you. So it's crazy because we started the record on different ends of the country.
Mm-hmm.
He was in Miami. I was in, you know what I'm saying, Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
I send it over and he was on 50,000,
oh,
man. He was just like, oh, man.
Oh, my
and,
God.
Called Captain. We was like, yo, whatever you need to do by the time you get to the studio, you just need to really feel like you're ready to party.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And Captain came in the studio and he killed it, man.
And
he killed
Captain
it.
Is, Captain is their artist
yes.
On Def Sun Jam.
Island Def Jam.
Gang over
yeah.
there.
Right. Island Def Jam.
Is it your label or over there? Is your mm-hmm. imprint?
Yeah, imprint. Yeah. Captain label. Is our first artist signed to the Write Your Life Entertainment. And that's WYL. Mm. You see right here, you know, Brandon.
You need what it is.
And Dave Massey, shout out to Dave Massey. Signed a project over there. He saw the vision that we have for Captain, man. And we're just not getting the ball rolling on him. So we've been signed over there for a little bit.
What a great start.
4 or 5 months. Okay. Like 5 months we've been signed.
I love that. So who wrote the lyrics?
Captain.
Oh yeah, Captain.
Captain.
Where did he grow up?
New Mexico. He's born in Detroit and raised in New Mexico.
There's there's things in the lyrics that are really kind of South Florida Cuban, you know?
Yep.
Captain's he's absolutely out of his mind, but he's so talented. You know what I mean? Like first time we saw to discover them. You know what I mean? I guess you can kind of tell the story about how you discovered them.
This young lady had a producer, checked out some beats.
See, I say you had with the ladies.
I said.
I've noticed this trend, right? Yeah. And I'm not mad at you.
I said, you know, you got anything that have songs on it? He played a couple of records with a hook, and he played this one song called like John Claude Van Damme, I'm the Man Damme, something like that. And it was so witty. I was just like, who is that? He's like, my man, we just be messing around making records. I said, I love to meet him. Mm-hmm. 2 days later, he's at the back door, knocking on the studio door. He walked in looking like, you know, a model, straight out of a magazine, man, straight surfer model kind of guy. I was like, nah, that's not you. So in my head, I'm thinking like, he doesn't write his own stuff. He's probably not a real artist. Man, I was dead wrong. Over that weekend, when he came in on a Friday, over that weekend, he did like 5 records, came in Monday. The records was like kind of like half-assed. Mm-hmm. And we was like, now it's time to go in to do some real records on them. And bam, now we're here.
That main lick on Ricky Ricardo, that, I love that lick.
Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah.
Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah. What's playing that?
Is it Bill Withers?
Yeah,
Bill Withers.
Oh, it's a
sample. It's
Bill.
All day to them, I'm thinking, what is that?
Man.
Yeah. So it was turned into a house mix, and two is like a house, man. House DJ on the low.
No. I respect the culture of just music, man. Mm-hmm. You got to be a scientist with this. So you have to actually do your homework. So I actually do my homework. I need to know my culture. I need to know, you know, where I'm from and what goes on in my city. And, you know, Deep House started in Chicago and New York, and those people was talented as hell, man. The creativity of those records was amazing. So I just had relationships with a lot of those guys and just sat down with them and just was like, yo, I want to use some of your catalog. And they was with it.
You know, speaking of that, let me take it a little bit another direction, because one of the things, just in meeting you guys in our initial conversation, I see a great attention to detail. I see vision. Like, not much that's happened with you guys is accidental. There is some stuff where just the universe comes together, or Lord, or whatever you believe in. I think it's Jesus. But but then once you have that opportunity, you guys are approaching this in really careful, manufactured, thoughtful, right?
Yeah.
I think that, you know, the coolest part about our team is, you know, we have two people that are passionate about the same thing and different things at the same time.
It's us.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So I'm in the studio and I'm passionate, you know what I mean, about what I'm doing and the knobs and the plugins and the twisting and the musicians. I'm crazy about it.
Yeah.
And then two on the other side is passionate about growing the company and the business and the brand.
Yep.
And like, there's so much business that goes into what we do that if it was all me by myself, we wouldn't be shit.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Right,
like,
right.
I think about the first time Puff Daddy came to the studio, you know, and he was like, so what is it I gotta do for y'all? You know what I mean? Do we need to get on a jet and blah, 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 you know, going in? I'm like, hell yeah, we need to get on a jet, Puff. What do you mean? Let's get on a jet tonight.
Right now. Right,
you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Two, on the other hand, didn't flinch.
Right.
He's like, yo, you came to our studio for a service.
Right.
You know, let's get this work done, because we're trying to build with you and we see whatever, and we can talk about Jet and all that shit later.
There you go.
And sent Puff on his way, and we had to go back to work.
There you go. So I would assume then that this, your entertainment company, is not a label imprint. It's much broader. I bet you're looking at every sector.
Yeah, it's bigger than that. You know, a lot of people want to get in the music business and be like, yo, it's crazy. Everybody walk around, they say, I have an artist.
Right.
You know, and really, what do that mean?
Right.
You know, I mean, because anybody can sign anybody and we all can say who we have.
That's right.
But for us, it's more of a business that we trying to create, man. You know, when you create a business, it has something to do with the culture, because the culture really involved itself in what kind of business you have going on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like right now, you know, technology is a forefront for everything.
Mm-hmm.
So we were just really trying to embody our business into, you know, the whole technology of what's going on right now, / you know, music, and then hopefully from the music, everything transcends to like different things, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So
it's a great
lesson for audience. We're just trying to just hit different facets of just being in business. It's bigger than the music. But it starts with the music.
You're living in the moment.
Yeah.
And you're taking advantage of what's available to you.
Yeah.
That's what we're doing. And
absolutely,
it's amazing. When you do that right,
absolutely,
and when you stay focused on that, there is no cap.
Yeah, no cap.
Because you guys are full-on TV stars now.
Well
yeah.
You know what's crazy? You know what's crazy about
those ladies at home?
Yeah, I seen the lady running for
Jay. And they both got
wearing
polos.
They be secure. Yeah, I know what's going on. We know what's going on.
See, it's hard for us three to turn red. He can turn red. I can't. But to your point, you know, we keep being amazed at what's going on with the show. because it's amazing.
Yeah.
So for guys in our space to be in the edge that we're on, it just keeps evolving. Mm-hmm. And the point to the audience really is, whatever you guys' age is, whatever our age is, it doesn't matter. If you take advantage of the tools and you do the work and you put in the grind, you can create your own opportunities and then make your own thing, right?
Yes, sir.
And congratulations to you guys.
Yeah,
this is going to record it, because not only, like, it's an honor for us to be here, because I was looking at Harmony's interview. I'm just like, yo, we got to be better than Harmony. Harmony's killing. He was killing it, though.
Right.
But it's like, when it's our moment, we got to go win. You know what I mean?
You guys have a secret weapon he didn't have.
What's that?
My fave, Fabienne Lays.
We did come in with Fab.
Yeah,
absolutely. Shout out to our manager, Fab.
Yeah, she's in the building. And she used to manage Dave. And we actually made a transition. We did a handoff to me through that. Fab is fantastic.
Yeah, I love her. She's my favorite. One of the things I noticed about you guys, I don't know if it's your Ritalin kicking in or poor toilet training as a child.
Here we go.
But there's something, you guys just love these repetitive parts. Like, I was just sitting here thinking of songs of yours I love, the Don, Nas.
Mm-hmm.
Repetitive parts. Repetitive parts. There's something in the way you guys hear music, you like these rhythmic, repetitive parts, and combined with the claps, combined with the house, and that's the formula. Go run out there and be.
It's crazy that you say that.
You ever thought
about it like that?
No, but you know what? It's not our fault, Dave. Shit, it's not our damn fault. Sean came in and said ass over again, and that's we have to work over
there,
again.
But what catches your ear is if somebody comes up to you and hums something at 130 beats per minute, you're going to turn it into a house song, and then you can turn that into a pop song, and then you're going to urbanize
that's true.
It. That's your formula.
Let's
go home. All right, come back next week.
Let me say something, though. Like, when we think about the formula to our club songs that go, right?
First of all, you guys don't have a formula. I'm teasing.
Oh, no. There is a little bit. There is a little truth.
You get some little things
true
you like.
To your madness.
Sure.
But we talk about in the studio, because sometimes, you know, we start our sessions at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And as the writers are writing, we say, yo, you know, this has to feel good drunk at 2 a.m. in the club.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's 2 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
But
you need to think about 2 a.m.
In the club when they start slamming the ones,
that's
you know what
right.
I mean? And
yep.
you're with your homies and you drunk, what feels great to say? ass.
Look at the visual, man.
Well, the problem is, I'm sitting
you
in a
your
room.
Careers in this man's hands, right? You guys are tied at the hip.
I have his visual, and I have your visual going. I'm affected by the show. You know, tee up batter's box. I might have to get us out of this.
Yeah. I was trying to go for writer's credit on an
publisher.
Idea. I was trying
right,
to
right,
your
that
manager.
Was happening.
I'll call Fab. We'll work
that
it out.
Was happening.
See, he speaks Spanish, so I actually put a little Latin thing so we can get a version for Captain.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Now I'm up to speed.
En español.
Why don't you tee your arm up and let's throw some batter's box at these
let's
guys.
Do it.
These guys are wonderful. You ready?
I'm ready.
Fire away.
Vocals. SSL Channel Strip.
Piano. Or Rhodes.
Ooh, it's the waves. Ah, it's a compressor. Let's do the R compressor.
Okay.
For the sake.
Kick drum.
808.
All day long.
All day.
I got an 810. Bass.
Trillion.
Nice.
Say that again?
Trillion.
Oh.
You like that?
Yeah.
You like that? You like that?
That's a To Catch a Predator moment right there. Melody.
James Fauntleroy.
There you go. Good one.
James is a friend of mine. I love
good
James.
One. Good one.
Virtual Sense.
First time I said rapid.
Electra X.
Analog Synth.
The Motif. Wait, does that count?
I'll accept that.
Okay.
Samples.
Thanks.
Two.
There you go.
I think you should be docked for that, but I'm gonna do it. Musical hero.
Ooh. Quincy Jones.
Wow.
You gotta say one too.
Come on, man. You took mine.
You can't use mine, so.
Musical hero.
That's a tough one.
Say it, man. Say his name. Y'all don't do him like this, man. This is your moment.
My musical hero, I'm going to say he's still alive, man. I'm going to give it to Timbaland, man.
Okay. Oh, wow. That's a good one. That's okay. A good one.
Okay.
Island plug-in.
Island plug-in.
You're stranded on a desert island. You get one plug-in. What would it be?
Oh, Nomad Factory Valve Driver.
Hmm.
Damn.
Wow.
You know, this is... This is World Series time. I think they did.
I should have said that.
They did.
I think they did it.
Erase it. Well, I gave you the secret. No.
Nobody watches this show.
not very many. Cosign went to some unique places that had never been done before.
I know.
Mentioned names. It was kind of Yasiel Puig like.
I know.
Like expressive, his own definition, but clearly groundbreaking, like clearly an athlete. Then two chimed in. Was sort of the cerebral counterpunch. Yeah.
Cerebral.
Boom, laid back.
Yeah.
Laid back. Yeah,
I think I should be a winner because it's two against one.
Well, the other part is we've not had a doubled up batter's box. Oh, maybe we did before. Maybe one other time. But this is the most unique one.
From next time we have two entrants, we need two. You and I need to gang up.
Oh, so we need another Dave, another Herb.
Yeah.
Okay. So four against two.
Yeah. Good job, guys.
Great job. The other thing that we have teed up is our guy, Chongor, who's in the corner
Chongor.
Office. Chongor, are you over there doing your thing, bud?
Yep, I got to raise my energy for the show.
Yeah?
Turn up.
The energy of the show is really crazy because we got such great guests. You got a few questions over there for him?
I got some really great questions.
Yeah?
This first one's from Derek Williams. When you guys started working together, how long before you guys found your groove, and are there roles split in productions?
We've been working together. Me and Cole's been partners for 9 years. The groove, it just kind of happened by experimenting. We was doing mixtapes for all the local artists. Well, a couple of local artists. I won't say all of them. Mm-hmm. And through those mixtapes, we found that we can make records.
Mm.
And from there, we just got the confidence and ran with it.
Mm-hmm. Chongor, give us another one.
From Brent Knight, when looking for new artists, what are some traits you guys look for and anything specific in the actual demos?
Man, you know, for me, it doesn't have to be perfect.
Right.
It could be a trash can, and it's how the songs are put together that makes me say, damn, you're creative.
Because
people just not creative no more. So you can sing, you can rap, congratulations.
Right.
But it's more about the creativity. Like, I can hear something that's not there musically, but it's how they put the words together and how the songs are structured.
How many songs does it take for you to know that person's truly got it?
I can only listen to, like, I could take two records. I could take two records and be like, you know. Yo, this person is different. Like, right. They're real unique. It doesn't take a lot.
So let me ask you on the artist side. Mm-hmm. See, I believe part of what you get when you have really stars is intuitive. It's not intellectual.
Mm-hmm.
I call it how you move the air in the room.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm sitting with somebody, right?
Yeah, that's real.
And when the air moves in the room, I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Do you feel that too?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Definitely.
And you can use that. Then we work out publishing.
I was about to say, can I borrow that?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, cool.
We work fab. I'll talk to you after this. Chongor, give us, did you have something, Dave?
Well, there's a flatulence joke in there somewhere.
I will. You're moving air in the room. I got it. Chongor, give us another one.
From Jack Taylor, if you start a song with the drums first, does the final song focus more on the groove and vice versa if you make the melody first with the emotion?
You know what? The song kind of tells you what the song wants to do. You know what I mean? Like, I know that sounds kind of crazy, but if you start off with the drums, right, but it's a song that is more acoustic driven, there's more guitar, there's more bass, like you'll realize as you start to fill up that track and it takes shape, you know, the drums are, they become distracting, you know what I mean? So then, you know, now you need to turn it down or go reference something. You know, I have all this acoustic stuff going, let me go listen to a John Mayer album. Oh, shit, his drums are minimal as hell, you know what I mean? Let me go back, let me relax, you know what I mean? So I kind of feel like the song talks to you as it takes shape.
Mm. Cosign, what you said earlier was when he came in the room, just that, You start with a concept, so when you say the song kind of tells you what to do, it's the concept of the song that kind of fills in all the little parts and pieces. It sounds like you guys always start with a concept, not a kick drum.
You know what? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. You know what I mean? One thing that we don't do is we don't have a set formula, because I feel like that blocks all creativity.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? So if Sean says, I have a hook, and I say, no, don't say nothing. I go make a completely different beat that has nothing to do with
what he had in his head, we just killed it, that moment.
Right.
So if the moment asks for the hook first, you know, and then we build around a hook, or if there's some chords going on and then somebody starts singing, well, it started with the chords, you know, but we're just open. We respect the like the creative process and the energy of the room.
And it's a trust question. I find it's about trusting your intuition.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Like saying, you know what, I'm gonna rely on this. That's how the show, whatever this show has become and whatever our contributions are, it's based on intuition.
Absolutely.
It's not two broadcasters. We just, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
And then you follow that.
Here's a question from me. And be honest.
Mm-hmm.
Approximately how many ideas do you have to come up with one dance or with one?
It's crazy because it's all about the moment. You guys, it's just like this.
Well, what I'm saying is like, do you take, is it like 25 songs, you get one that makes it to radio, or five songs, makes it to radio? How many songs do you have to do before one makes it to radio?
Well, you know what? Now it's a lot different.
At first,
it was 100 songs and then one got on the radio.
Yeah.
You know, but now, what we do now is crazy because now we'll spend 2, 3, 4 days, maybe even a week on a song that's gonna go to radio.
Uh-huh.
As opposed to making 100 tracks in a month or in 2 months.
But
you know,
but what's the difference with that too is once upon a time we made a catalog full of records. Now it's like, yo, we gotta get the interns in, So we physically in the studio with these artists cooking up. Mm-hmm. So the chances of getting on the album is way better than just being in the studio making records.
Absolutely. Chan Gore, last one, please.
From Carlos Matamorsa, when picking drum samples, what kind of sonic characteristics are you listening for? Is it a strong attack, a good body, etc.?
It all kind of depends. You know what I mean? Like some days it's like, you know, I just wait for my ears to get excited. If I give away one secret, when I'm going through sounds, whether it's synth sounds or whether it's drum sounds, as soon as I click on something and I say, man, what the fuck is that? Mm-hmm. When I never do that, whenever I do that, that's a great sound.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, it's like, oh, what is, all right, cool, try that. Mm-hmm. But do you hear how nasty that sound? Boom, you know? And so we just like grab a bunch of weird stuff because everybody's doing music. So like what you want is when you press play on your music, you want to have ear candy that's, if they've listened to 10 songs in a row, your song is going to stand out some way, somehow.
Absolutely.
You have to take pride in that.
What percentage of the process for you is your own engineering skill? In other words, are you shaping the sounds like I noticed on a lot of your songs, there's a lot of engineering going on in there.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you use your DAW in the process as part of the production technique.
Absolutely.
More than anybody I've heard recently.
Absolutely. For the longest, you know, from a tech side, you know, we would have incredible ideas, but they just wouldn't sound good. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I was just walking around with my head down all day because it's like, why don't my beats sound like the radio?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, what is the problem?
Mm-hmm.
And so once you start realizing, like, yo, you know, you got a kick that's crazy muddy in a bass line, and that's just what's making it sound muddy, and, you know, knowing to roll off, you know, some bottom on one and let the other person take the space, or side chain, or understanding that you should throw that L2 on the thing so your beat kind of punches at the end, you know, like really getting into that and understanding that.
Is this self-taught stuff?
Or? I was gonna ask, yeah.
It's
just absorbed from everybody.
Some of it is self-taught, some of it is Pensado's place.
There you go. I had to dig a little deep for that one. You know?
You know? Absolutely. You got it, though. You dug deep. Yeah, exactly.
Seriously, though.
Played him like a fiddle.
When we came out here, and you know from the first time when you missed our Melody Fiona thing, everywhere we went, it was like kid in the candy store questions before Dave could even play his mix. It was like, you're Dave Pensado. Sir, question about, you know, and we just did that everywhere until we got enough knowledge.
No, I learned,
You know?
That's what we do.
Yeah. You guys work a lot with Jason and
he's
like God.
Jason Joshua.
Jason is
like God.
Jason is so giving. I have to say that. Like, I have to say it on camera because, you know, he makes a living with all his engineering techniques. But sometimes I'm making a track and I want it to sound like what Jason's gonna do later, but it ain't got to him yet. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I call him. How do you make this 808 and this kick? What are you doing? Mm-hmm. And he will run it down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and people
don't
do
that. I do the same
thing.
Definitely
do the same thing.
Well, no, I'm saying I'll call Jason and ask him how he made this 808 song, and he'll just share it with you, you know?
Yeah. I remember when I called you about a Jamie D song and I was asking you a question and you were trying to tell me, and I think you knew that I wasn't getting what you were saying. And then you told me to just send you the vocal, and you did what you did, and you sent it back. And that was the nicest thing, you know?
And at the top, collaboration happened. People really understand that it's about how we work together, not how we work apart.
I mean, us and Jason is definitely a football team.
Yeah, that's right.
That's like quarterback, receiver, you know?
Yep.
I'll speak for Jason.
We learn a lot from the people we work with, too. It's a two-way street. Producers come up with cooler ideas than mix engineers do. And so we can technically manipulate some of those ideas. But it's a two-way street.
Three quick ones before we go. It goes so fast. One, from my perspective, I'm sure Dave's, I am excited about the industry's future because of guys like yourself.
Absolutely.
Appreciate that, man.
The combination of your skill set and your intellect, but you also haven't lost having fun.
Not at all.
And that energy is what goes into records and makes records happen. So don't ever, when somebody's coming down on you and you're in a bad space, call. Okay, we will erase all that because we need this energy. People understand how important that is. That's one.
Thank you.
Two, at some point in time, if you will allow us, I'd love to have our incredible videographer, Brian Peterson, put a GoPro camera or something in there to catch your process.
Oh, wow.
When you have sample, when you do whatever the case may be, and we do an ITL, we do a segment on that.
That'd be dope.
And I'd also love affordable healthcare to be in there doing what they're doing and catch that too.
Man. That's no problem.
Can we do that?
Yeah. Oh, we can have a blast with that. We can bring a little wine and cheese.
Okay.
All right. Wine and cheese, a little pepperoni circles.
There you go.
Man.
There we go. And then thirdly, don't have a hit without a pepperoni circle.
You gotta have it.
And then lastly, one of the things that you spoke about earlier that has become part of our mantra is you are teaching and education and how important that is. Because if we don't, and you talked about culture, because if we don't pass along what we've learned, it just dies.
Yeah.
So we're responsible stewards for that. So we do a lot of stuff, like we're going to Nashville. We do a lot of things where we appear around the country and we speak, and we try to bring in folks like yourself to talk to folks who want to know from you. So will you help us if we work that shit out?
It's crazy. I've been having a whole week, all last week. I said, yo, man, the word is accountability.
There you go.
And people have not been accountable in the industry, man. It's just like we've been force feeding so much that the people in the public think this is what it is.
Right. Right.
And nobody's held accountable. And like the people that's like in our seat have to start talking about it.
That's right.
And I'm just like, I can't sit back no more, man. Cause like the music that's coming out, even what people think the perception of things to be, just like this show is amazing. You know what I'm saying? Now you guys are on the level where you're held accountable to tell the people what's the truth and what's real.
That's right.
Amen. And it's just like we are in this space to be like, we're the interns, we make great music, but now we have to be accountable for our actions to let the people know what's up.
Well, here's what you should know. The Pensado platform is available to you to get that message out, to do what you need to do. We'll show you ways we're doing it. We're reaching a lot of people because of you guys. Mm-hmm. This is their show. We're the lucky messengers, right? And we're completely honored. But it doesn't happen without you guys. So
appreciate that.
I'm bugging Fab. I'm bugging y'all. As you know, I don't go away. You pick that up, right? So
no
thrilled
problem.
To have you.
Yeah,
great
no
call.
Problem.
Dave, take us home.
Hey, guys. Now, this is really important. I want you to look up some of the songs we've been discussing. Listen to those. Listen to them again. And then rerun the show. And this will really, really, it'll help you learn a lot. I've been doing this a minute, and I was listening to all their records. In fact, when they came in today to hang with me, I was listening to one of their records. And if I can do it, you should do it. And there's so much to learn when you listen to records made by creative people, and that's what we're sitting next to today, next week.